So let's start our discussion with the current water scenario across world as well as in India. So in order to understand the water scenario, we need to understand the water cycle. This is a very basic thing, but this is a very important natural phenomenon. Because of this phenomena, our existence of human being and all the living species is possible on this earth. If there is any damage to this water cycle, then entire ecosystem will collapse. So this water cycle is very simple, and nature provide water in a very recycled way, very proper way for our consumption as well as for the ecological needs. So because of the sunlight and because of the biological process, water gets evaporated from the ocean as well as from surface area, and some water gets evapotranspiration. This is a process from which water is extracted from the plants and trees, and this water rises in the environment and it gets transported. So because of evaporation and evapotranspiration, water vapors forms, clouds form, and these clouds get transported because of the wind. And since these clouds comes in a contact of cold weather or air, the precipitation occurs. So this is a very important source of water on this earth. Precipitation is one of the important source of water, as well as another source is a melting of glaciers or ice caps. So this is another source of water. And this water, we get this water in the form of runoff in the river. And also there is other aspects, surface runoff, then we have percolation, transmission, infiltration, and there are other processes. Ultimately what happens after utilization of this runoff water, whatever water is left in the river, it is eventually joins the sea. And again sea water gets evaporated. So this is a complete cycle, and this water cycle is very important for understanding this water subject. So next important thing is to quantify the how much quantum of water is available in this world and in our country. So all we know that about 70% of our earth surface is covered with water. Out of this surface, only 3% is a fresh water. And out of these 3%, only 0.3% water is a surface water. Rest water is a groundwater and other glaciers water. And out of this 0.3%, only 2% water is available in the rivers. So you can imagine how small fraction of the total available water is really available in our rivers. Coming to our country, India. Our country receives only 4% of water, so total quantum of water available in our country is only 4% of water which is available in a globe, and its quantum is about 4000 billion cubic meters. So I will express this unit to measure the quantum of water. This is a billion cubic meter, and of which available water is only 1869 BCM. That is, we can utilize only 47% of available water. And on this, and from this available water, we can utilize only 60%, because there are several constraints. We cannot store the entire water which falls on this ground, because of there are several constraints like topography, the storage condition, the submergence, the infrastructure cost, and there are so many constraints. So we can utilize only 1123 BCM of water, and the distribution of that water into surface water and groundwater is shown in this slide. About 690 BCM water we get from surface, and about 433 BCM water we get from ground. And on this water, about 2.5% land and about 18% population of world is dependent. So you can imagine how this there is a big disparity between the water availability and water required. So only 4% water and 18% population. So this is a very huge mismatch. And all these numbers are converted in the form of image. In this image you can see this is a quantum of all Earth's water. So in comparison with the Earth area or volume, the volume of Earth's water is shown in this on this slide, and the quantum of fresh water available in our lakes and river is shown as a simple dot. So you can imagine, although we can see huge water across the globe. The total quantum of water available in our river is very less as compared to the surface area. Coming to our Indian scenario, as I had already mentioned, the freshwater resources of our country is about 4000 billion cubic meter, and of this about 1047 BCM water is lost every year in the form of evaporation. It is unavoidable, as well as it is a part of our water cycle. So about 25% water is lost in the evaporation, and 1084 BCM water is not available because of several constraint, as I mentioned, and available water is about 1816 BCM, out of which usable water is only 1123, and its distribution is mentioned here. So why water is required, or in simple terms, in which sector water is utilized? So basically there are three sectors. First is a domestic water use, second is the industrial water use, and third is the agriculture water use. So domestic water use comprises the water used in our house for drinking purpose, cooking purpose, and other purposes. The industrial water use is the water required for some industrial processing, and agriculture water use is required for the growing of the crops and for irrigation activities. If we see the distribution of water use across the world, if we average all the numbers, so we can see that about 70% of water is used in agriculture sector across the globe. About 22% water is used in industrial sector, and only 8% water is used for drinking purpose, that is domestic purpose. If we segregate world's total water into two separate entities, first entity is low and mid income countries like India, and second compartment is high income countries like advanced countries like America and so on. So in low and mid income countries, about 82% water is used in agriculture sector, and there are several reasons. For example, one of the reason is the low productivity of crops is one of the reason for high utilization of water in the agriculture sector. Second, more population growth, which require more food, and in order to ensure food security, we need to grow more crops. Number three reason is we are less developed countries as compared to advanced or high income countries, and hence what happens, our dependence on agriculture sector is very large as compared to the advanced countries. And many a times what happens, these advanced countries import the crops which require, import the products which require huge water. So ultimately in return, we are exporting our valuable resource water to the high income countries. So these are some of the reasons for high water consumption in low and mid income countries. 10% water is used in industrial sector and 8% in domestic sector. Coming to the high income countries, as I mentioned, the high income countries are mostly industrialized countries. So 59% of water is used in the industrial sector. So this is the highest, biggest component, biggest water use sector, industrial sector. About 30% water is used in agriculture sector. So the reason are, as I mentioned, the improved water use efficiency might be the one of the reason. And second, the water required, the population is quite less, so they require less food, so their agriculture water is less. And on an average, domestic water use is about 11%. So this graph shows, this distribution shows, even though average figures looks like very simple, but if we go in detail, these figures speaks a lot of words. So coming to some legal provisions. So water is a state subject. So as per our constitution, India is a union of states. We have states and central government in power. And as per our constitution of India, the seventh schedule, list two, which speaks about the state subject. So water, including irrigation and canal, drainage and embankments, water storage and water project, water power, these all subjects belongs to this state government. And as per list one, which deals with the central subject, the subject of regulation and development of interstate rivers and river valley, to the extent to which such regulation and development under the control of union is declared by parliament by law to be expedient in the public interest. So in simple terms, the water management is a state subject. So every state has its water resource department or irrigation department, which manages all the water available within the state. So if we see the administrative structure, so at the highest level we have Ministry of Water Resources, like Jal Shakti Mandralay in today's term. So the objective of this ministry is to frame the water policies for the entire countries, and this department also executes the interstate projects, and they also govern the interstate rivers, matters related to the interstate rivers. At second level we have state government, where most of the water management happens. So this state government has two arms. One is a water resource department and another is a groundwater board. So these two agencies manages all the surface water as well as groundwater. And we also have local self government. So the irrigation projects having irrigable command area less than 100 hectares are managed by the local self government. So Panchayat Raj institutions has some role to be played in water management. So we have three tier structure, and at each level we have specific role assigned with respect to the water management. So now we will understand who are the stakeholders who are involved in the water resource management. So first we will discuss the management of surface water. So as I mentioned, we have water resources department or irrigation department in each state, which looks after the surface water. Then we also have local self government. The water is required. We have already seen that more than 80% water is used in agriculture sector. So agricultural department is major stakeholder in the water management. Then we have private lift irrigation scheme. So water is pumped and lifted at the higher elevation, and this water is being used for the irrigation purpose. We also have forest department, which manages water within the forest, and we also have industries and hydropower. So surface water is managed by these agencies. They are either regulators or users. In terms of groundwater, we have central groundwater board as well as state groundwater boards. And the actual user, so groundwater board is a regulator of that water, and the user is a private person who use open well or bore well and extract the groundwater. So now, after having some background of the water management in our country, let's deep dive in the sector of water challenges in the water management. So in this session we will discuss several challenges, and we will also discuss how to mitigate these challenges and what government had undertaken in order to mitigate these challenges. So water management, so water is a very precious natural resource. It is very vital for our existence on this earth, and it is important from development of from environmental perspective. It can be a matter of life as well as death, depending on how it occurs and how it is managed. So a perfect balance between the demand and supply, which meets the society water demands without exceeding the unmanageable threshold of water supplies, is crucial for the effective management of water. So we have two sides. One is a supply side and another is a demand side. On supply side, we supply water to the society, and on demand side, society demands water. So on supply side, there are two basic ingredients, parts. First is surface water, another is a groundwater. And on domestic side, there are users like domestic water users, industrial water users, and agriculture water users. So this is a very complex equation, and a perfect balance between these two needs a careful attention. And if this balance gets disturbed, it will cause environmental impacts as well as economical disaster. So water can be instrument for economical survival as well as growth, and vice versa is also true. So if water is not managed properly, it can cause an economical disaster. So now we will just list down the major challenges in the water resource management. So these are the tentative list, and there might be some challenges which are state specific or region specific or watershed specific or river basin specific. So we are discussing these challenges in general. So we will bifurcate these challenges into two parts. First is the external challenges and second is the internal challenges. So external challenges means those challenges which are not in our hand. So there is very little control in our hand to manage these challenges. So, and internal challenges mean the challenges within the organization or within the state which can be managed optimally. So first external challenge is a water scarcity. We'll discuss all these points one by one. Second challenge is temporal and spatial variation in rainfall. Third, uneven spatial availability of water across the space. Fourth is a decreasing per capita water availability. Fourth is a changing land use pattern. Fifth challenge is a small land holding. Then diversion of irrigation water for non-irrigation use. And last but not least is climate change impacts. Coming to the internal challenges, we have challenges of maintaining old infrastructure. We had created a very huge irrigation as well as water infrastructure like dams, canals, hydropower projects. And this infrastructure is aging because its age is quite high. So maintenance of this aging infrastructure is a big challenge. Then equitable water distribution is a challenge. Completion of ongoing irrigation project is avoiding its time and cost overrun is a challenge. Then we have participatory irrigation and water management concept. So how to empower these institutions is a big challenge. Then quality of water. So on external side, managing quantity of water was a challenge. From internal perspective, the water quality is a big concern for us. How to improve the water quality is a challenge. Then improving productivity of water. So as I mentioned, water is used for various use like domestic, industrial and irrigation purpose. So in each sector, how productivity of water can be enhanced is a big challenge for us. And last but not least is the capacity building. And the aim of such workshop is also to empower all the stakeholders and educate them or make aware them about the water sector. So capacity building is one of the important challenge. So now we will discuss external challenges one by one. So this is a very interesting map which classify the world in five parts. At the first part is the area shown in a blue color which has little or no water scarcity, means this area has abundance of water. Then the area which is shown in the orange color, which has physical water scarcity, means in this area the water availability is a constraint. So less water, for example Rajasthan or South India. So physical water scarcity is a big issue. Then approaching physical water scarcity. So difference between these two is there is a physical water scarcity as of now. And in this color coding, the physical water scarcity situation is approaching. It is very near. And this purple color indicates the area where there is an economic water scarcity. So what is different between physical water scarcity and economic water scarcity, we will discuss in the next slide. And there are some area for which estimate is not prepared. For example, such area, this area is shown. So very interestingly, on this slide, if we focus on India, so our part of India face economic water scarcity, which means purple color. So part of Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh and Northeast, there is a economic water scarcity, means water is available, but we don't have economical infrastructures in order to extract the water and make available this water to the users. Then our India has physical water scarcity as well. So there is some part where the rainfall is very low or groundwater level is very depleted. So water is not available in such places. And also we have some area where we are approaching to the physical water scarcity situation. Thus, in case of a country like India, there should not be a uniform policy for entire country, and watershed or river basin specific intervention in order to combat the issue of water scarcity is required. So as we just mentioned about the physical water scarcity as well as economic water scarcity, we will discuss these two terms. So in physical water scarcity, water demand is more than the water availability. So if water demand is more and water available is less, then such scarcity is known as a physical water scarcity, and its reason might be the because of the low rainfall or depleted groundwater. And it's what is the solution for this? So solution is efficient water management and water transfer from the surplus basin to the scarcity basin. In terms of economic water scarcity, so water is available in the basin, but there is a lack of water infrastructure in order to meet the water demands. And what is the solution? Solution is a technique. First, funding is required, and second, technical infrastructure building is required. So we will discuss in this slide the water stress area in our country. So if we see this graph is prepared by the Niti Aayog, and if you see this graph, we will learn that in our country, which is having low water stress, for example, the yellow regions means there is a less water stress, and red color means there is an extremely high water stress. So part of Punjab, Haryana, Delhi, Rajasthan, part of Gujarat, part of Maharashtra, these regions falls in the category of extremely high water stress area. And there are some part like eastern India, East India and some Himalayan area, then west area in the Western Ghat region, which has low water stress area. And if you see the numbers of water demand and water supply, so blue colors shows the water demand. So in 2008, the water demand was 634 BCM, whereas water supply was 650 BCM. So available water was 650 BCM, out of which we were extracting 634 BCM in 2008. But if we extrapolate our requirements and water availability, so it is estimated that in 2030 our water availability will be 744 BCM. So our water availability will be increased from 650 to 744 because of construction of new dams or augmentation of reservoirs, etc. So our storage will increase from 650 to 744, but our demand which will increase by twofold, more than twofold, from 634 to 1498 BCM. So there is a big gap. How to mitigate this gap is a big challenge for all of us. So more than 50% of our country face high to extremely high water stress. So this graph easily you can identify that most of this graph is in red shade. In 2008, water demand was 634 BCM and supply was 650 BCM. And in 2030, it is projected that demand will be 1498 BCM and supply will be just 744 BCM. Thus, there will be a challenge of water management. This is another interesting graph which shows water withdrawal as a percentage of total available water. So this graph shows what is quantum of water available, and based on this available water, how much water is extracted. So if we see the past numbers, in 1995, withdrawal of water is between 20 to 40% of available water in India. If we project in 2025, so our withdrawal will be more than 40% of available water. So our withdrawal is continuously increasing and availability is decreasing. Availability is also increasing, but not to the extent. Now, second important factor is a temporal variation in the rainfall. So in our country, this graph shows the monthly variation of rainfall starting from January to December. So each month, what is the average quantum of rainfall occurring in the entire country is shown in this figure. And from this figure, it is very clear that we have maximum rain falling during the period of June to September. So these four months contributes to our monsoon. So in our country, average rainfall is 1250 millimeters, but there is a big variation. So maximum rainfall is more than 10,000 millimeters, that is a more than 10 meters, and minimum rainfall is a less than 100 millimeters. So this is a huge variation in a temporal scale as well as in spatial scale. So main source of water is rainfall and snowmelt, as we discussed earlier. And rainfall is not uniform across time. India is characterized by monsoon rainfall, and it is typically occurs during a period of June to September of every year. So we are very fortunate that at least it is assured that we will get rain during this period, and if this rain do not occur, it will create severe drought situation. And within this period, if you see within this 4 month period, typically 80% of rain falls within 100 hours. So if we count actual hours of the rainfall, so 80% of the rain falls within 100 hours. So this is also very interesting, because during this 100 hours, we have to store the augment entire water available, as well as we have to release the water in the rivers in order to avoid the floods. So there is always a issue between water storage as well as water release from a dam. Hence, it is necessary to create storage and use this water for rest of the days. So normally what we do, we store the water available during this monsoon period, which is about 100 days, 100 hours, and we use this water for entire year. In this slide, we will discuss the spatial variation of rainfall. So from this slide, we discuss the temporal variation, means on time series, how water availability varies. And on this slide, we will discuss how water availability varies spatially across space, how water availability is different. So if we see the areas such as Rajasthan, so it is having very low rainfall zone. So rainfall is less than 100 millimeters. Again, there is a shadow area on the southern part, central southern part of our country, which is also characterized as a low rainfall zone. Then we have central India, say central part of the India, which has moderate rainfall. Then we have western Ghats and southern part of the India, which has a higher rainfall zone. Then we have extremely very high rainfall in the northeast part. Now we will discuss the annual average rainfall in our country. So as we discuss, rain is unevenly distributed across our country. So its distribution is very uneven. So this dark blue color indicates rainfall more than 250 centimeter, means 2.5 meter. So this part receives highest rainfall. Again, this part receives higher rainfall. These basins receive highest rainfall, and part of this receives highest rainfall. Thus, spatial and temporal variation in rainfall is a big challenge for water management. Variability results in floods or droughts. Thus, abundance is a problem and scarcity is also a problem. So, accurate availability of water, so whatever one quantum of water which is required by our stakeholder, it is a very unlikely situation that same quantum of water is made available by the nature. So we are constantly striving against the forces of nature. So water management is very crucial. And there is another constraint. For example, if we discuss about the topography of Maharashtra states, so we have Sahyadri ranges, the Western Ghats is known as the Sahyadri ranges in Maharashtra. And these mountain ranges having reduced level or altitude more than 650 meters. So the height of these mountain ranges is 650 meter above the sea level. And here rainfall is more than 5000 millimeters. So this is a high rainfall zone area. And on the just down, just northern side of this area, we have an area very flat topography which receives a rainfall between 800 millimeter to 1200 millimeter, and on the eastern side we have flat terrain, we have cultivable land, and its reduced level is just 500 to 600 meters, and there is a river valley portion. So because of this, and this area receives very low rainfall. So on one side there is a mountainous terrain, there is a high rainfall. On other side we have cultivable land but low rainfall. So our challenge is to construct dam in the Western Ghat region, store this water, either execute canal which will supply water from this rainfall zone to the cultivable land, or second necessity is to construct lift irrigation scheme. So in Maharashtra as well as in Karnataka you will find several huge lift irrigation projects, because topography doesn't allow gravitational flow of water in our jurisdiction. The next important challenge is a decreasing per capita water availability. So per capita water availability depends on two factors. First is the quantum of available water, and second factor is the population. Although available water is a relatively constant, it is increasing to some extent, but we can say that it is a generally constant as compared to population. But population rises, and there are, because of this reason, the per capita water availability is not constant every, so it is every year if you see the numbers, it is a declining. And generally decrease, the per capita water availability decreases over time for a country like India. For our country, PCWA is a decreasing nature. So this figure, this chart will give you some idea about the renewable water resources in selected countries in 2017, and its unit is 1000 cubic meter per capita. So for example, if you consider the water availability across various countries varies in great extent. So there are countries like Canada where per person water availability is 79,24,000 cubic meter per person. Whereas if you see a country like India, we have 1430 cubic meter of water per person, and this happens because of more population and less water availability. We have only 4% water and 18% population, hence per capita water availability is very less. And at second number there is Brazil, where water availability is more than 41,000 cubic meter, and so on. Then the per capita water availability is, if we compare the India with lower middle income countries, so in lower middle income countries the per capita water availability is 3013 cubic meter per person, whereas in India we have 1430 cubic meter. So India is not at par with the at least lower middle income countries. And the worst situation is this: the per capita water availability is not increasing, or it is not constant, in fact it is a decreasing. So generally a country having per capita water availability less than 1700 cubic meter is known as a water stress country. So this is the line, this yellow line shows the water stress line, and there is another line, this line, and today India is a water stress country because in 2011 the per capita water availability is less than 1700 cubic meter. There is another term which is known as a water scarcity line. So if water per capita water availability goes below the 1000 cubic meter per person, then the country is known as a water scarcity country, and if India will be close to the water scarcity country by 2050. So we are very close to approaching this scarcity line. So this is a cause for, this is a reason for our concern, and that's why we are discussing this. So another thing, the water demands are increasing. So as we discussed, there are several demands of water. First, water is required for irrigation, then for domestic purpose, domestic means home purpose, drinking, cooking, like that. Industries water use, power water use, maybe hydropower, the thermal power plants, like that. Then inland navigation, some states required water to be released for facilitating the navigation. Then we have ecological water need, and evaporation loss is unavoidable. So if we see the in 1997 we were fortunate in order to mitigate the our water requirement. So water availability as well as water demand are matching, so there was not a big concern for that. But if you extrapolate these numbers in 2025, our demand will be more than the availability, and in 2050 the irrigation water demand will be increased by about 800 billion cubic meters. So it is very important that the increasing per capita increasing water demand and the per capita water availability, these are conflicting and these are very serious issue for our country. The water demand in 2025 will exceed the water availability, so this is a cause for concern. Then we have land use, land changes and small land holding. So if we map entire country and if we see the land having irrigation facilities and land where there is a built up area. So because of urbanization and industrialization, there are several area which is under irrigation. It is being converted into the non-irrigation. So because of this, these land use land changes, the irrigation sector becomes shrinking. It is shrinking, and also the small land holding is a causing problem. The land use is continuously changing. Agriculture land is brought under non-agriculture, is converted for non-agriculture use through a process known as urbanization. The land holding is decreasing due to the growth of population, and due to these two factors, irrigation activity becomes a challenge in order to achieve food security. Then this is very interesting thing. It is known as a water, energy and food nexus. So in this slide you can see there are three components. First is water, second is food, and third is the energy, and these three are interdependent. And there are another three factors, which first is the climate change, second is the population growth, and third is the governability. And in order to achieve water security, food security and energy security, the water becomes a crucial part, and the challenging forces are these three: climate change, population growth and governability. So water security, if you study the water security, then keeping all other two things constant, then our estimate may not be accurate, because energy is required for water distribution. Because if we want to construct a water supply plant, we need water treatment plant as well as distribution network. We need to pump the water. For pumping of this water, or filtering of this water, or water, treating this water, or for wastewater treatment, energy is required. So water distribution itself requires energy. So it has interdependence. Second, if we study the water security, the energy generation requires water. Say hydropower or any thermal power generation, it requires water. So unless we have water, we cannot create energy. And on third dimension, if we want to ensure food security, it requires both things. For example, agriculture requires energy as well as water. If water is there, this water needs to be lifted from well or some pond, and it is treated and it is distributed to the farm. So agriculture requires water as well as energy. Also, the agriculture produce requires energy. The energy in the form of cold storage or transportation or distribution requires energy. So this is a very complex thing, and hence it is known as a water energy food nexus. And population growth, climate change and governance are key challenges in our future. Then we have competing demand for water. So earlier we had discussed this thing, but we will discuss in detail. As we discuss, water is demanded by agriculture sector, domestic sector as well as industry sector. Also, water is required in order to sustain the environment. So these demands for all the demands for all these sectors are increasing. So all the sector, agricultural sector demand more water, domestic sector because of consumption oriented life cycle, we require more per capita water. Industry require more water, also environment also needs some water. And this, since we concentrate on these three factors, rarely we actually release the water for environment. So water availability is not increasing, or although it is increasing very slightly, and the demand is increasing exponentially. So if you see the 2006 statistics, the supply as well as demand are matching, but in 2030 the demand will be the more than supply. So there will be the competition between the sectoral allocation. For example, there will be the competition from within in irrigation sector and domestic sector, and this may result in rural urban conflicts. Last external factor is the climate change impact. So climate change effect affects the water resources, and how in which way it affects. So because of climate change, air temperature increases, and because of this, total precipitation may increase or decrease. So model studies is required in order to ascertain whether rainfall will increase or decrease, because some part of our planet the rainfall is increasing, at some places rainfall is decreasing. So proper model analysis is required. And if water availability is increasing, it does not mean that it is beneficial, because this water availability is an instantaneous increased water availability. So such event will cause the water blast, and it will result into floods, because we don't have adequate infrastructure in order to store huge quantum of water occurring or rainfall occurring in a small interval. So more precipitation as rain than snow due to higher temperature. And if water precipitation decreases, then it will have its own consequences. Then earlier runoff from same snow melt. So there will be runoff from snow melt, and there will be low snow peaks, snow packs. Then these changes will bring several ecosystem changes. Then there will be changes in timing and amount of river flows. So river operation, the dam operation becomes critical, because now we are operating dam based on some curve rule method, and we have, based on the past data, we know how much quantum of water is coming, what level we have to maintain in order to predict the future inflow and in order to have a safe water storage. But if there is uncertainty of water availability because of the erratic rainfall, then there will be the huge challenge in the water management. So changes in the there will be challenges in the water system, water resources system operations, and ultimately it will result sea level rise. So from hydraulic perspective, there will be the huge climate change impacts on water management, and this, if water is not properly managed, it will cause aggravate the situation, and it will have adverse impacts. So till now we had discussed about 50% of our presentation. Now in the next part we will discuss the internal challenges. So these are very important, but as compared to the external challenges, these are manageable challenges. First is the aging of water infrastructure. So water infrastructure means dams, canals, hydropower, lifts. These are the water infrastructure, and the dams are artificial barriers constructed on rivers which store water and help, and this water is used for irrigation, power generation, flood moderation, and for water supply, drinking water supply. And in India, if we the dams higher than 50 meter or between 10 to 50 meters height that fulfill certain additional design conditions are known as a large dam. So there is a certain specific definition of large dam defined by the ICOLD, and as of June 2019, our country has more than 5700 large dams. And over 75% of these dams, over 75% of dams in India are more than 20 years old. And about 220 dams are more than 100 years old. So you can imagine how situation is difficult for dam management, and aging of water infrastructure is a big concern. And most of these large dams are in Maharashtra. About 2,394 dams are in Maharashtra, 906 dams are in Madhya Pradesh, and 632 dams are in Gujarat. So in order to repair and maintain this infrastructure, government requires huge fund. And now you might be knowing that there is a program known as a DRIP. You just Google it and you will know the get the information. So World Bank had given financial assistance in order to protect our water infrastructure, and in several states this project is going on. Then second biggest challenge is a water equitable water distribution. So equitable water, there is a difference between equitable water distribution and equal water distribution. So in equitable water distribution, so water is equitably distributed. So based on demand, supply and other legal constraint, water is distributed based on some specified characteristics. So water is supplied for various use, as we discussed. So in case of irrigation use, water is generally supplied through dams and canals, and if there is a canal, then water distribution across the command area is not uniform. So in a canal, there is a head reach and tail reach, and generally tail reach does not receive ample amount of water or specified quota of the water. So unequal distribution within the command area is a big concern for the state. Also, if there is a well irrigation, if somebody is extracting water from the groundwater, then the access to groundwater is a concern, number one. Number two is a financial viability. The farmer should be financially sound to purchase pump, motor and pay the electricity bill. And if he is not competent to bear these charges, he remains deprived from the water, although water is available. So in such case, the concept of equitable water distribution does not fulfill. In another case, if we consider the domestic water use, the water supply depends on location. If you study any city, for example Pune or Hyderabad, there are some part within a city which receive less quantum of water. So there are some part in a city which receives suppose 200 liters per capita per day of water, and on the other side there is a some part which received just 50 LPCD of water. So this distribution is not an equitable water distribution. And equitable access to the water for all the stakeholder is a big challenge. Now next is a very important concept known as a participatory water management. It is known as a PWM or PIM. PIM means participatory irrigation management. Generally in case of agriculture sector, irrigation management is a big concern, and participation of all the stakeholder is expected in planning, execution and operation of the water resource project. An example of this PIM is water management for irrigation purpose through water user associations. So these water user associations are the body created by the department or state government which encompasses all the farmers who are the stakeholder of this association, and these institutions are empowered by the law. And in many states there are laws, but these agencies or water user associations needs to be strengthened. There is a need for strengthening of these WUAs. Then most important concern is the water quality. So in our country, more than 100 million people live in an area of poor water quality. And this diagram shows there are some spots where water quality standards are not followed. So groundwater quality, the number of BIS standard breaches is mentioned in this figure. And this is a very serious concern for all of us. So basically we have two types of water. First is the groundwater and surface water. And quality of water of ground water as well as surface water is a big concern. If we are polluting ground water, then we are destroying the resource for the future generation as well, because purification or recycling of groundwater is a very difficult task, and if once it is diluted, it is an irreversible process and it is very difficult. And as I mentioned, more than 7% of our population live in an area of poor water quality. Then how to this is one of the challenge to get to improve our water productivity. So at present level, we use more quantum water for generation of one unit of agriculture product. This is also true for the industrial outcome as well as for domestic water use. So water use productivity needs to be improved in irrigation, domestic sector as well as industry sector. And last challenge in the internal class is a capacity building. So there are levels of capacity building. So through this such workshop, like through presentation, we are focusing the capacity building of individuals. Then we need to improve the capacity of the organization as a whole. Then we need to make awareness about the water sector in some specific field, like irrigation sector, agriculture sector, domestic sector, like. And then we have sectoral level capacity building. So entire sector encompassing all the stakeholders needs to be educated, and at the last, if this state is achieved, the national capacity building can be achieved, and awareness shall be increased of all the stakeholders, and in the process all stakeholders shall be involved. So how to mitigate these challenges? So in the upcoming slides, we will discuss some of the measures which we can undertake in order to mitigate these challenges. So it is not possible to mitigate all the challenges in one stroke, and even though if we mitigate some of the challenges, it is sure that water being a natural resource, there will be the another challenges, because which may be occurred because of implementation of our solution itself. So first way ahead is water use shall be made more efficient. For irrigation sector, there is a need of micro irrigation and piped irrigation network. So I will, in one of the next upcoming slide, I will discuss the necessity of piped irrigation network and how PDN will improve our overall irrigation efficiency by twofolds. Then in the domestic and industry sector, recycling and reuse of water is a prime important. Then we need to have some supply side intervention. For example, we need to have more storages. Then we need to devise the mechanisms in order to prevent or reduce evaporation. We need to undertake river linking projects to some extent in order to bring water from abundant region to the scarcity region. Then we should not only depend on the supply side intervention. We should also work on the demand side intervention. In supply side intervention, we can improve the quantum of water availability. But in supply side intervention, we can limit or we can reduce the water demand. So low water requiring crop variety can be research can be undertaken in order to devise low crop requiring crops. Then we should decrease the water demand by efficiently using water, as we mentioned earlier. And our focus should be on agriculture sector. Why I am saying this, I will explain in upcoming slides. About if we study the Indian agriculture sector, more than 50% of our workforce is employed in agriculture sector. The GDP contribution of agriculture sector is more than 17%, and total population is about 130 crores, and it is our country is the second most populous country. It is the fifth largest economy and seventh country in terms of area. So in terms of agriculture, there are several achievements. We rank first in the production of pulses, milk and jute. We rank second in the production of rice, wheat, sugarcane, groundnut, etc. But there are issues. Which are these issues? So issues is agricultural yield is lower, then small land holding is a big issue, dependence on monsoon for water is a issue, climate and disasters, we are witnessing this, there are several floods as well as droughts, then inadequate access to irrigation, then loss of fertility of soil because of over irrigation or repeating the same crop, then missing market linkages, then storage of the production, crop production, then adoption of modern techniques and agroclimatic variability and diverse ecosystem. These are the issues. Then food security is a big challenge for our country, and Food and Agriculture Organization defines food security as a situation where all people have all time, this is a very important word, all people have all time physical and economic access, means they should have throughout the year physical access as well as economic access, so they should be financially empowered to buy sufficient, safe and nutritious food that meets the dietary needs and food preferences for a healthy and active life. So this is a proper definition of the food security. And despite of high level of food production, about 15% of the population is undernourished. So this is a big challenge. On one side we have ample food production, and on other side we have 15% population undernourished. From employment, economy, food security perspective, water and agriculture are important sectors for India. I will discuss the need of piped irrigation system in India. So as we discussed in the first slide or first or second slide, that irrigation sector uses more than 80% of water. And if we study the water use efficiency in irrigation sector, the design canal efficiency of conventional canal irrigation system. So what is canal irrigation system? So water is being supplied through open canals, which is either lined or unlined, and its design efficiency is about 45 to 50%, but actual efficiency is just 15 to 25%. So this means that if we release 100 liters of water from dam, actually only 20 liter reaches to the root of crop. So about 75 liter or 80 liter of water is either being wasted, or it is evaporated, or it is stolen by other persons. So these losses are huge, and it is necessary to increase this efficiency in order to satisfy the needs of other sectors. So if we improve this efficiency, the quantum of water which is made available, it can be utilized for the other sector, or we can bring more area under cultivation. So increasing water use efficiency from 20% to say 60%, we can irrigate 200% more area. So this will avoid waterlogging, control water supply, equitable distribution, less land acquisition, and avoid head loss, and it will also require minimum number of structures. So in this slide I will discuss how conventional canal system look like. So in a conventional canal system, we have a river, then we have a structure for water diversion. So this is a structure like a dam. Then we have a canal, generally it is known as a main canal, which is uptaking from a dam or reservoir. And generally any dam has a two canal, either left bank canal or right bank canal. The canal uptaking from the right side of the dam is known as a right bank canal. The canal uptaking from the left side of dam is known as a left bank canal. So depending on the terrain and water distribution, dam may have LBC or RBC. So this is a main canal. Then we have branch canal. So canal uptaking from main canal and having discharge more than 3 cubic is known as a branch canal. Then we have distributary canal. This is a distributary canal which is uptaking from branch canal, and its discharge is between 0.75 to 0.5 cubic. Then we have minor. This is a minor. It uptakes from distributary and its discharge is 0.05 to 0.5 cubic. And ultimately we have fill channel. So fill channel is a very small channel which deliver the water from minor to the farm. And ultimately we have outlet. So this is a farm area, and ultimately through this network we are supplying water to the farm. So if I release 100 liter of water from this point, ultimately I get only 25 liters because of the several losses as we discuss. And if we use pipe distribution network, so now we have several combination of pipe distribution network, and we have three things. First is the pipe distribution network, then we have filled channels. These are the filled channel, and at the end we have filled application system. So we have basically three types of filled application. First is a flow irrigation, second is a micro irrigation, or which encompasses sprinkler irrigation and drip irrigation. So if we supply water through pipe irrigation network, and if we have filled channel and all the distribution network in pipe distribution, and if we have these three system at the field level, what will be the efficiency? So researchers have carried out this research, and it reveals that if we migrate from the conventional system to pipe irrigation system, our irrigation efficiency increases from 50% to say 80% or 90%. So suppose this is a reservoir, this is a main canal, this is a branch canal uptaking from main canal, then we have distributary canal, and ultimately we have minor, then we have fill channel. If we use this network, our efficiency becomes multiplication of all components efficiency, that is efficiency of canal distribution network is equal to efficiency of field application. So what, how water is applied on the field, efficiency of the field channel, this is a field channel, and efficiency of the canal system. So generally efficiency of field channel is 0.7, efficiency of the canal is a 0.7, and field application efficiency is also 0.7. so if we multiply all these factors, our canal the efficiency of canal distribution network is just 34%. So if we use flow irrigation system instead of flow, if we go for sprinkler irrigation, our efficiency increases to 42%. If we use our entire network in a open canal system, and if we use drip irrigation, our efficiency increases to 50%. Thus for all canal distribution network, our efficiency ranges from 34% to 50%. Now if we convert minor the channels between minor and field channel into pipe network, then our efficiency comes out to be 39%. For sprinkler it is a 49%, and for drip it is a 59%. So if we replace this part into the pipe, our efficiency increases from 34% to 39%, and thus efficiency is between 39% to 59%. If we replace distribution network, minor network, and all the field channel into pipe, and if we use flow irrigation, our efficiency is 45%. For sprinkler it is a 56%, for drip is it is a 68%. So overall efficiency is a 45% to 68%. And second last combination is if we have main canal and then entire network in a pipe network, and if we use flow irrigation system, then our efficiency becomes 51%. For sprinkler it is a 64%, for drip it is a 77%. And at highest level, if we convert entire network into pipe distribution, and if we use flow application, then our efficiency is 59%, for sprinkler it is a 74%, for drip it is about 90%. Thus for pipe distribution network, our efficiency is a multiplication of this factor. 0.97% is a field 0.97% is a field application efficiency, which is improved because of the drip application of drip. Another 0.97 because we had converted open canal into the PDN, and 0.95 for the main pipeline. So total efficiency is about 90%. So this intervention can bring enormous changes in the irrigation water management. And in Maharashtra we had started this initiative, and we are now adopting pipe irrigation network at various projects. Then I just want to highlight one of the aspect, which is known as a ICT, means information and communication technology. So we can use satellite images, drones, sensors for data collection. So water management requires huge database collection and analysis of database. So using the tools of ICT, we can collect this data. So we can use satellite data, drone data and sensor data, climatic data, soil data, so on. And we can use the artificial intelligence for data analysis. Then we can use Internet of Things, SCADA, and there are sensors for real-time monitoring and control. And using big data and GIS, the water management becomes very easy. So my intent of showing this slide to you is that now you are much, all the students are aware about the water challenges. So question is, how to mitigate these or one of these water challenges using tool of ICT? This may be the project for you for your BTech study or MTech study. And if you study in this field, I am confident that in your entire life, this study will be very useful for your personal personal understanding as well as for social reason. And at the end, I just want to say few words about the World Water Day. So today we are celebrating World Water Day, and World Water Day is celebrated across the world on 22nd March, and since 1993 it is celebrated. And this year theme of World Water Day is valuing water. So we should value the water, and there is a difference between the value of water and price of water. Nowadays we are paying the price of water, and the value of water is a more than the price of water. We are just paying the service cost, and which is also subsidized by the government, because water is a vital requirement of the living being. So we are not respecting the value of water. So in order to create awareness about the value of water, the World Water Day is being celebrated across the globe, and all the stakeholders which are using water should be aware about this value of this scarce water resource. And that's all from my side. Thank you very much for your patient listening. Thank you.